Welcome to the Gershwin Connection. Dave Grusin is your host as you explore the life and music of one of the best love songwriters of all time, George Gershwin. Arrange your own program of Gershwin classics as you see the people and places he knew and hear recorded broadcasts of the composer himself talking, playing, and conducting. There's even an old-time piano roll of Gershwin's own interpretation of his music. And Dave Grusin is on hand to answer questions about performing and recording Gershwin. It's all here, and you're in control. For help with how to use this program, move the arrow to the question mark at the lower right and click either button on your hand control. Anytime you want, you can skip the rest of these instructions by clicking either button on your hand control. Don't press either button unless you want to interrupt these instructions. Right now, you're looking at the street. From here, you can go to any of our featured attractions. Anywhere you go, the question mark button will be available. Click on it anytime for help with how to use the program. In each feature, buttons across the lower screen put you in control. To go to a dialogue of questions and answers with Dave Grusin, click on Ask Dave. To hear radio broadcasts of George Gershwin performing and talking about his music, click on Radio shows. For a program of Dave Grusin performing Gershwin favorites, click on the big billboard. To hear a performance recorded on a piano roll by George Gershwin himself, click on Piano Roll. To see a list of artists who perform the songs on this disc, click on Liner Notes. To exit the program, click on the door. To see each button's name, move the arrow over the button. To stop the liner notes while they're playing, click on Pause. The Pause button changes to Play. To resume playing the liner notes, click on Play. After the credits end, click on Play to start them over again. To go back to the street, click on Back.
I've had a lifelong love affair with the music of George Gershwin. As a child, I heard all of this material, and I realize now in retrospect that it's wonderful material for jazz use, and it's been performed by a lot of respectable and significant jazz performers over the years. And somehow I thought maybe it's time, after all this time, for me to take a shot at it. And I find it as fresh in the 90s as it was when it was written in the 20s and 30s. I think the construction of the original songs is so hip and so far ahead of its time that we'll never outgrow and outlive the significance of this material. So that when I think about the melodies and about the harmonic changes and about the rhythmic kind of experimentation that he was doing that nobody else was really doing in those years, I find the modernism connected with his music to be amazing that it happened that long ago. So we're talking about the 20s and 30s, and here we are in the 90s, and it all still sounds fresh. The track that is different from most of the other things, significantly different from everything else on the record, is I Got Plenty of Nothing. And I had some kind of preconception in mind, some kind of New Orleans street feel for that tune. And I thought, okay, well, we'll just go in and knock this one out. And this turned out to be maybe the most problematic. And in fact, I thought we were going to drop it at one point. And I didn't think it was going to survive the cut. But thanks to my funky brother, Don Grusin, we managed to pull it out at the last moment. And I love the way it came out. And I love the contrast between the kind of ragtime and Bo Diddley feel, or whatever you want to call it, but without getting too analytical, I just when things are supposed to happen, they'll somehow happen, and that's what happened with this track. This project was never intended to be a solo project. I had thought about using my friends on the label as guest artists even before the Gershwin material was chosen as a vehicle, and once I had decided to do the Gershwin material, everybody's selections became kind of clear to me. And in fact, the fact that we had Gary Burton available and Eddie Daniels and Sal Marquez and everybody that played on the record, in a sense, these guys determined by the nature of their own particular specific abilities and talents, they determined which tunes they would play on, even though there was never any discussion about it. I do come from a musical family in the sense that my father was a very good violinist and my mother was a pianist. I think of my father still as maybe the best musician I've ever met, in the sense that he had such an all-encompassing feeling for music that he surrounded us with, without getting pushy about it. He just made the environment a musical environment, and my brother and I both, I think, benefited from that sort of subliminal education that we got. When I think about my childhood, my mother liked popular piano, and one of the pieces of music, the sheet music that was sitting on our piano all those years, was Summertime from Porgy and Bess. And I still remember the wonderful graphic, and we've researched to try to find out who designed this, but it was a very distinctive profile figure of Porgy actually on the music. And when I think about the piano as a kid in the living room, I think about that piece of music sitting on it. Probably the most technically difficult track to get together was Fascinating Rhythm. And I think one reason might be that we decided to do it in 7 instead of 4-4. So it's like 7-8 instead of 4-4. All that means is we're dropping one eighth note at the end of every bar. And we're not doing it arbitrarily. The reason I decided to do it this way is that if you sing the song the way it was written and clap along, it's ba da 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 da. So there's whatever that is, 4 bars of symmetrical stuff, and he put this kind of asymmetrical line over the top of that. And all I did was take what he did, which is da 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 da, and instead of adding his beat to it, I started over at that point. So I'm going da 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 da. And in doing it that way, it threw everything over into 7. So I thought, well, this is great. This is gonna tickle all of us, you know, as musicians, and we'll see if we can get through it. Well, by the time we got to the part that goes ba da 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 da, 7 no longer works. So we put that in 6, and the result was we had a piece that is exactly the piece, but it's in another time frame, and kind of threw us into a different improvisatory idea. Well, I would say we took basically a week of tracks. That's the bare bones rhythm section tracks for this thing. I think maybe a total of 6 days in the studio. And we don't go forever in the studio. I can't stay awake anymore that long. But I'd say a good 8 to 10 hours a day. And then there was some sweetening after that, although in this particular album, there was a lot of good stuff that happened on the performance itself. In addition to the rhythm section tracks, I did a string session with a couple of functions to sweeten some of the tracks we had made, and also to do the medley, the Porgy and Bess medley, live, in which I played piano and the strings were there at the same time, and we were all in the studio at the same time. So it went down fairly quickly as a record. Mostly because it was acoustic and it was a performance record. When I was thinking about the structure of this record, I wasn't sure that it would be accepted commercially in terms of having a lot of sales. I thought that the music was timely, and that we would probably get some critical good reviews from people who were interested in the, kind of the future of bebop, and also the tradition, the line that has gone on from early jazz works into contemporary jazz. I was hoping for that, and indeed we got some good notices. But I don't think artists ought to think too much about how many records are going to sell, not while they're working on the record. I mean, it'd be great to go beat on the record company when you're done and make them get out and promote the record. But I think it gets in the way if we stop during the creative process and worry about the commerciality of it. But in this case, it did work out, and of course, we're very grateful for that.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I've just played for you my personal arrangements of Fascinating Rhythm and Liza. I play these two tunes so many times at parties that I've naturally been led to compose numerous variations, the sort of thing every composer does when he is called upon to manipulate his own stuff over and over again. You just heard the result. At Rudy's request, I'm going to play for you something decidedly different in mood and tempo, a sort of blue lullaby, one of my 3 piano preludes. has himself been newspaper interviewed practically into a coma, I've always cherished a desire to try the other end of the job and to do a little interviewing myself. So this afternoon I cornered George, asked questions very much at random, and took notes. I tried to think of questions you might ask yourselves if you had the opportunity. For instance, George, here's the query all composers encounter three times a day. When you work with your brother Ira, which comes first, the words or the music?
Usually the music. I hit on a new tune, play it for Ira, and he hums it all over the place for a while until he gets an idea for the lyrics, and then we work the thing out together.
Are you working on anything new right now, George?
Yes, Ira and I are working on a new show called Pardon My English. The thing is already in rehearsal, and we're still trying to finish the score.
What contemporary American composers do you most admire?
Jerome Kern and Irving Berlin. Both of them have been very helpful to me. Incidentally, I believe Kern's Showboat score to be the finest light opera achievement in the history of American music.
And I agree with you. Tell me, how did you get your start in music, George?
Well, I left high school to take a job as a song plugger at Remix for $15 a week.
That's 45 less than I used to get. Remember, I said I was going to ask questions any member of the audience might think of. How much money do you make now, George?
About half as much as you do, Rudy. How much is that?
One third as much as I told you this afternoon, you liar. Now, look, George, let's remember we're artists after all. One more question. Which of your show tunes do you prefer yourself?
This one, Rudy.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm just...
You can play any of the 12 selections on the list, or you can set up your own program of the selections using the buttons across the lower screen. To see each button's name, move the arrow over the button. To play a selection from the list, click on the title. To move forward through the list, move the arrow to the bottom of the screen. To move backward through the list, move the arrow to the top of the screen. To set up your own program of selections from the list, click on Program. A grid of boxes appears. Find the first song you want in your program on the list and click on it. The number of the song appears in the first box. Repeat this procedure with as many songs as you want in your program. If you want to clear your program and start over, click on Clear. When your program is ready, click on OK. Play can function different ways, depending on whether or not you have created a program. If you have created a program of songs, Play will play through your program. If you have not created a program, Play will play through all the songs on the list in order. To repeat a song or a group of songs, click on Repeat. Then click on a song title or on Play. To go back to single play, click on Repeat again. While the selections are playing, you won't see the control buttons on screen. Just click either button on your hand control, and an on-screen control bar will appear. To go back to the street, click on Back.